وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى my beloved brothers and sisters in the entire month of Ramadan بإذن الله الكريم I'm going to be sharing with you the tafsir of selected portions of the Qur'an for the entire month with you. 30 places from the Qur'an every single day for the 30 days of Ramadan, insha'Allah ta'ala, you bi'idhnillahi al-kareem be receiving the tafsir of either a verse or two or even more or a whole entire surah. Bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Today, insha'Allah ta'ala, is the first episode, or it's the first day of Ramadan, and I'm going to share with you the tafsir of the surah in which Allah started the Quran with, Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's a surah in which every single Muslim needs to know its meaning, because it's the surah that we recite in every single prayer of ours. And we recite it in every single rak'ah in which we pray. So inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to start with Surah Al-Fatiha, and then I'm going to select ayat or two per day inshallah ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. رَبِّ شَرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلُ الْعُقْدَةً مِّن لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. This surah is called Surah Al-Fatiha. And it's got many names. From the names that it has is it's called Fatihatul Kitab. And it's called Ummul Quran. It's called Ummul Kitab. It's called As-Sab'ul Mathani. And it is also called Al-Quran Al-Azim. Al-Quran Al-Azim. It's also called Surah Al-Hamd. Those are names of it. The first one, which is Fatihatul Kitab. Al-Imam Ibn Jarir Al-Tabari in his tafsir, he says, سميت فاتحة الكتاب. It was called فاتحة الكتاب لأنها يفتتح بكتابتها المصاحف. The reason why it's called فاتحة الكتاب is the mushaf that we have, the writing starts with سورة الفاتحة. And that's why it's called فاتحة الكتاب. يعني يفتتح بكتابتها المصاحف. The mushaf, the first surah that was written in the Mus'haf is Surah Al-Fatiha. The opening is what it will loosely translate in English. وَيُقْرَأُ بِهَا فِي الصَّلَوَاتِ. And it is what you recite in the prayer. Yeah, you start the beginning of the prayer after you've done your dua and the adhkar. The first thing that you recite from the Quran is Surah Al-Fatiha. So that's why it's called Surah Al-Fatiha, بِفَاتِحَةُ الْكِتَابِ. He said, فَهِيَ فَوَاتِحَ. It's the opening لِمَا يَتْلُوهَا مِنْ سُوَرِ الْقُرْآنِ فِي الْكِتَابَةِ وَالْقِرَاءَةِ. And then he summarizes it for you and he says, it is the opening surah, the chapter of the Qur'an in terms of what? In terms of writing. So if you look at the Mus'haf and you open it, the first surah that was written is Surah Al-Fatiha. And also the first surah that you recite in the prayer is none other than this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha. So that's the first name that is given, is called Fatihatul Kitab. The second name that is given is Ummul Quran, the mother of the Quran. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari also explains it in his tafsir. He says, Summiyat Ummul Quran, it was called Ummul Quran, لِتَقَدُّمِهَا عَلَى سَائِرِ سُوَرِ الْقُرْآنِ. The reason why it's called Ummul Quran is because it supersedes all the other remaining chapters of the Quran. And then he says, وَتَأَخُّرِ مَا سِوَاهَا. All of the other surahs in the Qur'an, they go behind it. And Surah Al-Fatiha comes first. يعني it supersedes all of them. All of them, they go behind it. في القراءة والكتابة, in terms of reading and recitation. وذلك من معناها شبيه بمعنى فاتحة الكتاب. Here, it's similar to فاتحة الكتاب. Because remember, the mother supersedes everybody else. She's the forefront. The mother is more important than the father, right? So this surah is more important than any other surah in the Qur'an. He says it here. He says, وَإِنَّمَا قِيلَ لَهَا لِكَوْنِهَا كَذَلِكَ أُمَّ الْقُرْآنِ. And that's why it's called the mother of the Qur'an. لِتَسْمِيَةِ الْعَرَبِ كُلَّ جَامِعٍ. The Arabs, they call everything that's comprehensive. كُلَّ جَامِعِ أَمْرًا. Everything, anything that encompasses and has in it everything, they call it أو مقدما لأمر. Or if it supersedes and goes before other things, they call it إذا كانت له توابع تتبعه. If it has things that follow it. It's called السبع المثاني, the seven verses that repeats itself. And Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari explains why it's called it. He says, أما تأويل اسمها أنها سبع فإنها سبع آيات. It's seven verses. لا خلاف بين الجميع من القراء والعلماء في ذلك. No scholar differed with any scholar that the surah, that Surah Al-Fatiha has seven verses in it. Yes, they differed in where the seven verses are, but they didn't differ there are seven verses, and that this surah is seven verses. Okay. وأما وصف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم آياتها السبع بأنهن مثاني فلأنها تثنى قراءة في كل صلاة تطوع ومكتوبة وكذلك كان الحسن البصري يتأول ذلك. It's called سبع المثاني because it's repeated. Every single rak'ah you're repeating these seven verses. Whether it's an obligatory prayer or whether it's a voluntary prayer, you have to keep repeating it. So that's its name. It's called سبع المثاني. Also from the name is that it's called and it has is القرآن العظيم. And Imam al-Qurtubi, he said, سميت بذلك, the reason why it was called قرآن العظيم, لتضمنها جميع علوم القرآن. Because Surah Al-Fatiha, it gathers in it all of the sciences related to the Qur'an. Everything that you need is inside there. أنها تشمل على الثناء على الله. Praising Allah عز وجل is there بأوصاف كماله وجلاله. Also, وعلى الأمر بالعبادات والإخلاص فيها. The concept of commanding the people to come with acts of worship and sincerity is also in there. والاعتراف بالعجز عن القيام بشيء منها إلا بإعانته تعالى. Also accepting that you as a person are weak and you're unable to do anything if Allah doesn't help you with it, سبحانه وتعالى. Surah Al-Fatiha consists of that. وعلى الابتهال إليه في الهداية إلى الصراط المستقيم. Also humbling yourself for him, سبحانه وتعالى, begging him to guide you to the straight path. وكفاية أحوال الناكثين. وعلى بيان عاقبة الجاحدين. And he mentions the final outcome and the final dealing of the criminals and the stubborn and the hard-headed ones. And in this surah, it mentions jami'a ulum al-Qur'an. All of the things that are mentioned in the other place in the Qur'an, it has it. So that's why he says it's called Qur'an al-Azim. Okay? From its names, also that is called Surah al-Hamd. And Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, mentions in his tafsir, he says, وَسُمِّيَتْ بِذَلِكَ, it was called Surah al-Hamd. لكونها مفتتحة بالحمد, because it starts with الحمد لله رب العالمين. Brothers and sisters, this surah, its names are not just randomly chosen. I explain the meanings of those names, but they're not randomly chosen. In other words, those names are taken from the Prophet ﷺ and from the Quran as well. The Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit, which is found in Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. So the Prophet said, he said, there's no prayer for the person who doesn't read فاتحة, بفاتحة الكتاب. So the Prophet, he called it here what? He called it فاتحة الكتاب. In the hadith of Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنهما, she said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخفف الركعتين اللتين قبل صلاة الصبح حتى إني لأقول هل قرأ بأم الكتاب. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she referred to it as what? Ummul Qura, Ummul Kitabi. Okay, she referred to it as what? As Ummul Kitabi, which is an evidence for it. So it's taken from these narrations. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, we mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ummul Qur'ani hiya sab'al mathani wal Qur'ani al-azim. He mentioned the Prophet said this. Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So the hadith of Aisha you can find in Bukhari, the hadith of Abu Hurairah you can find in Bukhari. And also the fourth one is the hadith of Abi Sa'id ibn al-Mu'alla radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, مر بي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet, he came by me, وأنا أصلي, I was praying. فدعاني, and he called me. فلم آتيه حتى صليت. I never went to him until I prayed. ثم أتيت, then I finally came to him. فقال, he then said to me, ما منعك أن تأتي. What stopped you from coming? قلت, I said, كنت أصلي, I was praying, O Messenger of Allah. That's why I couldn't come to you. فقال, the Prophet then said, ألم يقول الله. Did Allah not say in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم لما يحييكم. Did Allah not say in the Quran, O those of you who believe, obey Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and the Messenger if they call you to that which will give you life. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to this noble companion, أَلَا أُعَلِّمُكَ, shall I not teach you أَعْظَمَ سُورَةٍ فِي الْقُرْآنِ, the greatest surah in the Quran, قَبْلَ أَنْ أَخْرُجَ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ, before you leave the masjid. فَذَهَبَ النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left, لِيَخْرُجَ, I mean the Prophet wanted to leave the masjid, لِيَخْرُجَ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ. Then the Sahabi said, فَذَكَّرْتُهُ, I told him of this, I reminded him, I said, O Messenger of Allah, you promised me something. The Prophet was about to leave. After he promised the Sahabi that he was going to tell him it, the Prophet forgot and was about to leave. The Sahabi grabbed the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, you promised me that you were going to tell me the greatest surah in the Quran. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. He has sab'u al-mathani. It's the seven verses that repeats itself. Wal Qur'an al-azim. Alladhi utitu, which I was given. So the Prophet referred to it here as what? Sab'u al-mathani. The seven verses that repeats itself. And he also referred to it as Wal Qur'an al-azim. Surah Al-Fatiha, brothers and sisters, has very large number of fada'il, virtues. It has khasa'is, distinct things that Allah has given it subhanahu wa ta'ala that you can find in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This surah, it's light. وَلَمْ يُؤْتِهَا نَبِيٌّ قَبْلَ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. It's actually light. Allah has never given it to a Prophet before Nabi Muhammad. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he mentioned, قال, he said, بينما جبريل قاعد عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Jibril was قاعد next to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. سمع نقيضا من فوقه. They heard a noise from high above. فرفع رأسه, he raised his head up. فقال, he said then, هذا باب من السماء. That's the door. Jibril is telling the Prophet this. He said, هذا باب من السماء فتح. That's a door from the sky that has been opened. لم يفتح قط. It has never been opened إلا اليوم, except this day today. فنزل منه ملك, an angel came down. فقال, he said, هذا ملك نزل إلى الأرض. Then Jibril told the Prophet, said, and he said to him, this is an angel that came down to the earth. لم ينزل قط إلا اليوم, he's never come down except this day. فسلم وقال, and then the angel gave greetings, gave salams, and he said, أبشر بنوريني, glad tidings for two lights. أوتيتها, أوتيتهما, which you've been given. لم يؤتها, لم يؤتهما, they have both not been given. نبي قبلك, a prophet before you was never given this light. فاتحة الكتاب, سورة الفاتحة, وخواتيم سورة البقرة, and the ending of سورة البقرة. لن تقرأ بحرف منها إلا أعطيته. There's not a letter in سورة البقرة, the last verses of سورة البقرة and سورة الفاتحة, that you recite them except you'll be given what you ask for. So that's from the virtue of this surah. From the virtue of the surah. Also, Surah Al-Fatiha is a munajatun fi salati bayna al-abdi wa rabbihi. It's a conversation, a dialogue that's taking place between Allah and His creation. The hadith Abi Huraira narrated, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man salla salatan, anyone who prays a salah, lam yaqra' fiha bi umm al-Qur'an, and he doesn't recite umm al-Qur'an, fahiya khidajun. And he said this three times. And the word khidaj means غيرو تماما, it's not complete. Then they said to Abu Huraira, إِنَّا نَكُونُ وَرَاءَ الْإِمَامِ, we pray behind the imam. فَقَالَ, and we pray behind the imam. What do we do in a situation like that where he's reciting? So then Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he said, اِقْرَأْ بِهَا فِي نَفْسِكَ, you read it to yourself. فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ, I divided the prayer between me and my slave into two. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, this is a hadith Qudsi. قَسَمْتُ, I divided, الصَّلَاةَ, the prayer, بيني وبين عبدي نصفين. It's divided into two. Okay. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. My slave will be given what he asks for. فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ. If the slave says, الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says, حَمَدَنِي عَبْدِي. My slave has praised me. وَإِذَا قَالَ. When the slave says, الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah تبارك وتعالى says, أَثْنَى عَلَيَّ عَبْدِي. My slave has continued in praising me. وَإِذَا قَالَ. When the slave says, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينَ. Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says, مَجَّدَنِي عَبْدِي. And another marra, he says, فَوَّضَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي. My slave has passed on his affairs to me. فَإِذَا قَالَ. When the slave says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Allah تبارك وتعالى responds and he says, هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي. This is between me and my slave. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. My slave will be given what he asks for. فَإِذَا قَالَ. If the slave says, إِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. If he says that, no. Allah تبارك وتعالى responds and he says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. That is for my slave and my slave will be given what he asks for. So this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, is a munajat. It's a dialogue and it's a call from the creation to the creator, where the creator, Allah Azza wa Jalla, is responding to the creation. Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated that. Specifically that narration, Al-Imam Muslim narrated, Bukhari didn't narrate it. Then we go into the virtue of it, which is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us, hadith Bukhari Muslim, in hadith Ubadah ibn Samit, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There's no prayer for you if you don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. So this is from the virtues of the surah. Also, this surah is a cure. It's a ruqyatun shafiyatun بإذن الله تعالى. With the permission of Allah, it cures people. We all know the famous hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. وأبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه mentions, he said, انطلق نفر من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. A group of the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم left في سفرة سافروها, a journey which they embarked on. حتى نزلوا على حي من أحياء العرب, until they came to a village from the village of the Arabs. فاستضافوهم, they asked them to take them as guests. فأبوا أن يضيفوهم, and they refused to take them as a guest. فلودغ سيد ذلك الحي. The master or the chief, the tribal leader of that land or that village, he got bitten by a scorpion or he got bitten by something. فَسَعُوا لَهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. So they tried everything, his people, they tried everything to bring cure for him. لَا يَنْفَعُهُ شَيْءٌ. Nothing benefited him whatsoever. فَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ. Some of them, they responded and they said, لَوْ أَتَيْتُمْ هَؤُلَاءِ الرَّحْطَ. If only you guys can come to this group of people that we refused, we rejected. The ones that we rejected, يعني أبي سعيد الخدري and his followers. الذين نزلوا. These ones, the ones who asked us to take them as guests, why don't we go to them and see what they can do for us? لعله أن يكون عند بعضهم شيء. Some of them might have something to offer. فأتوهم, they came to them. فقالوا, they responded and they said, يا أيها الرهط. Oh you, يعني, you this group. إِنَّ سَيِّدَنَا لُودِغْ. Our master has been bitten. وَسَعَيْنَا لَهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We tried everything to do for him. لَا يَنْفَعُهُ. It doesn't benefit him. فَهَلْ عِنْدَ أَحَدٍ مِنْكُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Has anyone of you have got anything to offer? فَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ نَعَمْ. Some of them, they said yes. وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَرْقِي. Wallahi, I can give ruqya. I know how to do it. I can help him. I can help you guys. ولكن, but this is with a condition. وَلَكِنْ وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ اسْتَضَفْنَاكُمْ فَلَمْ تُضَيِّفُونَ. We asked you guys to take us as a guest. You refused. فما أنا براق لكم حتى تجعلوا لنا جعلا. And we're not going to do anything for you guys until you give us a portion. There has to be an agreement, a financial agreement. فصالحوهم على قطيع من الغنم. So they agreed on a portion of goats. فانطلق, the Sahabi went, when the Sahabas, they went and they started to what? يتفل. They started to recite on them, عليهم, عليه, on the master. They started to read on him. And all they recited on him was Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin Surah Al-Fatiha. When they recited on him, فَكَأَنَّمَا نُشِطَ مِنْ عِقَالٍ. It was as though he was freed from the rope that was, like, it's like he was tied up on something. The tie, يعني, the knots were opening. The man, he felt free. فَانْطَلَقَ يَمْشِي. He started to walk. وَمَا بِهِ قَلَبَةٌ. And there was nothing to him. يعني قَلَبَةٌ. الصاحب غريب الحديث. النهاية في غريب الحديث ابن أثير. He mentions, he says, قلبة, it means alamun wa illa. It was like no illness. The man had nothing. Nothing happened to him. No illness whatsoever. Qala. After that, they said, okay, you know what? Awfuhum ju'lahum. Let's give them what we promised them. Alladhi salahuhum ma'alayh. They gave them what they promised. So then some of them said to the other, let's divide it. Iqsimu. Let's divide the, what we got. The one that did the ruqya, which is Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he said, لا تفعلوا, don't do this. حتى نأتي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Let's go to the Prophet and discuss with him. Ya Rasulullah, we did this. Let's ask him. فَنَذْكُرُ لَهُ الَّذِي كَانَ. We tell the Prophet what happened, what took place. فَنَنْظُرَ مَا يَأْمُرُنَا. We're going to see what the Prophet does for us, عليه الصلاة والسلام. فَقَدِمْنَا عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. We came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَذَكَرُوا لَهُ. They told him. And then the Prophet said to them, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ أَنَّهَا رُقْيَةٌ. Who told you guys that Surah Al-Fatiha is a ruqya? How did you guys know? ثم قال, the Prophet then said to them, قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ. What you guys did was right. اقسموا. Divide it amongst yourselves. وَضْرِبُوا لِي مَعَكُمْ سَهْمًا. And place for me something. فَضَحِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ. And the Prophet, he laughed. صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ. So those are the virtues and the benefits in Surah Al-Fatiha. A man got, يعني, Allah gave him health just by Surah Al-Fatiha. If we learn it, which many of us already know it, just read Surah Al-Fatiha. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullahu ta'ala in his kitab al-Da'wa al-Dawa, he mentions that whilst he was in Mecca, he got ill rahimahullah, and he said that I couldn't find any doctors or anything, so all I used to resort to is just read Surah Al-Fatiha. And he said, I saw so much يعني, benefits in it, that whenever someone would come to me and complain, I would prescribe for them Surah Al-Fatiha. I would prescribe for them. And they would also feel the same thing as well. So Surah Al-Fatiha, brothers and sisters, those are the virtues in it. Surah Al-Fatiha, brothers and sisters, is a Surah Makkiyah nazalat qabla al-Hijrah. It's a Surah Makkiyah and it came down qabla al-Hijrah, before Hijrah. Which is qawlu jumhur ahlil ilm. It's the view of the majority of the scholars. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari mentions it. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah mentions it. Ibn Ashur also mentions it. Rahimahumullah. May Allah be pleased with all of them. And the evidence that it's a surah makkiyah nazalat qabla al-hijrah is the ayah in which it's mentioned. There's an ayah in which it's mentioned, and that ayah is in a surah which is makkiyah. So then that means Surah Al-Fatiha must have come down before this, which is Surah Al-Hijr. Surah Al-Hijr is a surah makkiyah. Okay? And in there Allah mentioned Surah Al-Fatiha, which is وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ. We gave you سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. And we already mentioned سَبْعًا الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ is what? It's Surah Al-Fatiha. In the hadith Abi Sa'id ibn Mu'alla, رضي الله تعالى عنه, found in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet said it, عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, الحمد لله رب العالمين هي السبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم الذي أوتيته. The Prophet said that, عليه الصلاة والسلام. إذن, this ayah, سورة الحجر, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. It's سورة مكية بالإجماع, by unanimous agreement, it's سورة مكية. Okay? So, Fatiha came down before it. Came before it, of course, in that case. So that based on that, we're going to say that أن سورة الفاتحة مكية. سورة الفاتحة, it's مكية and it came down before the هجرة. Before the Prophet migrated to Medina عليه الصلاة والسلام. And also from the evidence, which is the second evidence, is that the salah of a person لا تصح إلا بها. There's no salah that will be accepted from you. We mentioned hadith in Sahihain من حديث عبادة بن صامت. لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There's no prayer for the person who does not recite Fatiha. Okay? Your salah is not accepted. And we know that the salah was prescribed 3 years before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to what? Medina. Before he migrated from Mecca to Medina, the Prophet ﷺ, the salah was made obligatory on him. So that means Fatiha must have been prescribed or sent down before that. Surah Al-Fatiha, brothers and sisters, it revolves around three main points. Three main points. The whole surah, it discusses and it revolves around mainly three points. The first one is At-ta'rifu bil-ma'budi tabaraka wa ta'ala. It lets the creation know about their creator. It's allowing to know who your creator is, about him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's number one. And number two is Bayanu tariq al-ubudiyyah. It teaches you the way to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the path of servitude. Okay, and last but not least, it tells you and explains to you bayani ahwal an-nasi ma'a hadha at-tariq. It tells you that path, how the people are. And it divides the people into three. The Christians and the Jews, and the believers. That's what Surah Al-Fatiha talks about. Those three main points. That's what it discusses. Allowing the creation to know about the Creator. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, all of those. You're getting to know who Allah is. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Tariq Al-Ubudiyyah. The path to Ibadah. And that it's done with what? With ikhlas. Iyaka na'bud, as we're going to see inshallah ta'ala. Only you, Allah, we worship. And then it talks about the people, ahwali nasi ma'a hadha at-tariq. The people, when it comes to that path of worshipping Allah, that they are what? Maghdubi alayhim and walad dalin. Those who Allah is angry with, which is the Jews. Walad dalin, the misguided ones, which are the Christians. And then an'amta alayhim, those who Allah is pleased with, which are the mu'minin. جعلني الله وإياكم. May Allah make us all from them. So that's the overall objectives, or the overall meaning that Surah Al-Fatiha revolves around. Also in there you're going to learn, brothers and sisters, you're going to take from the Surah in there as well. Those are the main three points it goes back to. But in this you learn about Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala's characteristics. You learn about the Day of Judgment. You also learn about singling Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala in worship. Okay? It talks about the Sirat al-Mustaqim, Tariq al-Muhtadeen, the path of the guided ones. It talks about staying away from the two paths that many people fall into, which is al-Maghdubi alayhim wa al-Dalin, the Christians and the Jews, and not to imitate them. Okay? So Surah Al-Fatiha, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to go through it. All of that was an introduction to the surah. Now I'm going to go into the tafsir of the surah in two ways, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to try to summarize it quickly, bi'idhnillah al-kareem. I'm going to give you the overall meaning, and then I'm going to give you, bi'idhnillah al-kareem, the detailed explanation of it, inshallah ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He informs us subhanahu wa ta'ala that complete praise is for Him. That He deserves it alone. No one deserves praise except Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Completely and utterly is for Him. Okay? And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala guides His creation to that. To praise Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. To glorify Him. To honor Him. To speak highly of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He also informs them that Jami' al-Mahamid, all of praise, He's the one who deserves it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala informs us that He's very merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah is the King of all kings. The King of what? All kings, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, Dhu-Rahma, He's very merciful to His creation. He's Malik, He's the King of all kings. Everyone else's kingdom comes to an end, but His one doesn't. Yawmul Qiyamah, where there's no king who can even choose to speak. He can't utter a word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who's able to speak today. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala guides us right after that He is the only one who we should worship. And that we won't be able to worship Him alone, unless He helps us and aids us with it. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He guides us subhanahu wa ta'ala to request from Him guidance. Okay? And that guidance is only in His hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the guidance of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is, the path to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is a straight path. It's sirat, which is mustaqim. It's an upright path. It's a straight path. And that there are paths that are deviated from that. and that they are the path of who? The path of al-maghdubi alayhim and the dalil, which are the nasara. There's a word in there that's mentioned, which is rabb. The word al-rabb in the Arabic language, it means al-sayyid, al-malik, al-muslih, al-salih, al-sahib. That's what it means. Al-murabbi, al-khaliq, al-ma'bud. All of those, it means it. And us, the original usage of it is islahu al-shay'i wal-qiyami alayhi. As sahib mu'jam maqayis al-lugha, also al-mufradat lil-raghib al-asfahani, al-kulliyat by al-kafawi, they mention, which is that the word rabb, it means islahu al-shay'i, it's the one that perfects things and stands up for it. And the word as-sirat, which is also mentioned in there, is his path. The word as-sirat just means at-tariq. Now let's look at the word iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. We need to know this because it's very important for us, especially it's a matter of aqeedah it enters. The word iyyaka, it's a damir, and you study this in one of the basic books of Arabic grammar, and that is none other than the kitab al-ajrumiyah. The word iyyaka is a damir, it's a pronoun. And the damair are types, but this type is known as damiru munfasil. It's a disconnected pronoun, meaning it stands by itself. Some dhamair are muttasil, they are connected. So this dhamir is a what? This dhamir is munfasil, it's disconnected. And also you study in ajrumiyyah that the iyyaka is a dhamiru nasb. It's known as dhamiru nasb. Okay? And you study the alamat al-i'rab, you study it, that there are three types, or four types. Four from the signs, from the generally speaking, not just alamat al-nasb. Because this is a pronoun, and a pronoun doesn't fall under i'rab. It's a mabni. The nouns are three types, right? We've studied this before in ajrumiyyah, which is ism mudhar, ism mudmar, ism mubham. The Arabic language, the nouns are divided into three. There's a pronoun, there's an apparent noun, okay? And there's also a ism mudhar, which is an apparent noun, okay? A proper noun. There's a pronoun, falls under the noun in the Arabic language. In English, it doesn't. The third one is known as isim, which is mubham. An isim which is mubham, it's a vague, ambiguous noun. And that is like ismu ishara and ismu mawsool, hadha and alladhi. Ala kulli hal, the other two types of isim, which is mudmar and the mubham, are both mabni. The only one which is mu'rab is the ism which is mudhar. Iyaka is a dhamir. A dhamir is what, brothers and sisters? It's already mabni. So we're going to come to that, inshallah ta'ala. Like in iya, I'm talking about here. It's a dhamiru nasbin munfasil. Mabniyun ala as-sukuni. Fi mahalli nasb. Maf'ulun bihi muqaddam. This is the point you need to focus on. In the Arabic language, the structure of a sentence is normally a verb, and then you have the subject, and then you have the object. So it's a fi'l, fa'il, and a maf'ul. Here what happened is that iya went before. It went before, okay? It's an object now. It's the maf'ulun bih, and maf'ulun bih is muqaddam. It went before na'budu. So you say iyaka na'budu. Normally, normal sentence, it will be na'budu. Na'buduka. I'm a na'budu iyaka. That's normal. What do you mean? Here have iyaka na'bud. Iyaka na'bud. Because we just said that iya is a dhamir munfasil. It's a dhamir. Nasb munfasil. Mabniun ala sukun. Because it's iya. Because ittisalihi likaf al-khitab. So it's iya. There's sukuna. مبنوع على السكون لكن the position it's sitting in is في محل نصب مفعول به. The مفعول به is مقدم. It came before what? لنعبد. It came before لنعبد. Why did it not go after it? There's something that comes from it. By saying إياك نعبد, what you're basically trying to say is it's a معنى which is known as حصر. Oh Allah, there's no one else we worship except you. So those people who are calling on to other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and are reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, they're contradicting themselves. They are contradicting themselves. They are what? They're contradicting themselves. Are we all together, brothers? The kaf in there is also, it's the kaf is a dhamir connected to iyyaka. Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters, it means, quickly go over it, inshallah ta'ala. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen means, oh Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, you are the one who all of the praises is for, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbil Alameen, the Lord of the universes. The word Alhamdu, it means وَوَصْفُ الْمَحْمُودِ سُبْحَانَهُ بِالْكَمَالِ. You're describing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to be complete. مَعَ مَحَبَّتِ whilst you love him. وَتَعْظِيمِ جَلَّ وَعَلَى. And you're honoring him. Allah is a ismu, is lafdhu al-jalala. And in there is what? In there is صِفَةُ الْأُلُوهِيَةِ لَهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. You're making for him subhanahu wa ta'ala that he is a ilah. And a ilah is a مَأْلُوهُنَ الْمَعْبُودِ. It's the one that's worshipped. رب العالمين, the word رب, it means السيد, المالك, المدبر, لجميع العالمين, the entire universe. وكل ما سوى الله تعالى عالم. Everything besides Allah تبارك وتعالى is a universe, right? من جميع أصناف المخلوقات في كل زمان ومكان. All of, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, He says, قال فرعون وما رب العالمين قال رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما إن كنتم موقنين قال لمن حوله ألا تستمعون قال ربكم ورب آبائكم الأولين قال إن رسولكم الذي أرسل إليكم لمجنون قال رب المشرق والمغرب وما بينهما إن كنتم تعقلون. So the word رب العالمين, it means كل ما سوى الله, everything besides Allah تبارك وتعالى. الرحمن and الرحيم, what are they? الرحمن and الرحيم, the most merciful, the most gracious, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and the most gracious, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Both of these names, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, are mushtaqani min Ar-Rahma. They're both taken from the word Ar-Rahma. But there's a slight difference between them. Okay? The word Ar-Rahman and the word Ar-Rahim. Okay? Ar-Rahman comes from the wazn, the structure in the Arabic language known as fa'lan. Rahman, fa'lan. According to the Arabs, anything that comes in that wazn, waznu fa'lan, it tufidul kathrata wassa'a. It benefits vastness and that something is a lot. Okay? وَلِذَلِكَ if you say غَضْبَان, غَضْبَان, فَرْحَان, فَعْلَان, غضبان means I am excessively angry. عطشان, I'm excessively thirsty. So anything that comes in that form of فعلان is what? تفيد الكثرة. It benefits something being a lot and سعة, something being vast. Okay? So then here it means الرحمن, it means ذو الرحمة الواسعة لجميع خلقه. Allah's mercy is so vast and it's so much for everybody from the creation, Christians, Muslims, non-Muslims, it doesn't matter. That's what Ar-Rahman means. Ar-Rahim, on the other hand, brothers and sisters, it means ذو رحمة خاصة. The rahmah here is not, it's not for everybody. It's a rahmah which is restricted, and it's only restricted to who? عباده المؤمنين. It's restricted only for the mu'minin. ولذلك الله تبارك وتعالى, He mentions in the Quran when He speaks about His mercy, look what he says وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. Allah is Rahim to the believers. So he used that characteristic of Rahim. He said وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. Also Allah تبارك وتعالى, He says يُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرْحَمُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُقْلَبُونَ. He punishes whoever he wishes and he shows mercy to whoever he wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that one is Ar-Rahman. First one, يُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرْحَمُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُقْلَبُونَ. Here, it's Ar-Rahman, meaning Muslim, non-Muslim, it doesn't matter for whoever he wants. But like for the believers, it is Ar-Rahim. That's if we take the opinion that Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim are both sifa fi'liya, and one is, يعني, if we say both of them are sifa fi'liya, then that means this one is general and this one specific. That's one view, by the way. It's one view. If you say Ar-Rahman is sifa fi'liya and Ar-Rahim is sifa fi'liya, then what's the difference? The difference is that Ar-Rahman is, because it comes from the structure of fa'lan, it means that it's kathra wa sa'ah, okay? And then Ar-Rahim is what? Ar-Rahim is khasa, specific to the believers, wa kana bil mu'minin ar-Rahima. Some scholars, they say that's not a strong argument. Which we're not going to go into now. So what's the right way? They said Ar-Rahman is a sifa dhatiya. Sifa dhatiya means it's a sifatun which is a characteristics which is la yazalu ama ma zala wa la yazalu muttasifan biha. Allah is always this characteristics, like al-ilm wal-qudratu wal-basar wal-sam'u, all of these characteristics, they're called sifat dhatiya, يعني they're always connected to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And Ar-Rahim, on the other hand, is sifa fi'liya. It's now that it's what? Muta'alliqatun bimashi'atihi. It's connected to his mashi'ah. Like a nuzul. He does it when he wishes. And then they said, yu'adhibu man yasha' wa yarhamu man yasha' wa ilayhi tuqlabun. And that same second view seems more stronger when you look at the Quranic discourse. Wa la'ilmu inda Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Maliki yawmiddin. Maliki yawmiddin is what, brothers and sisters? It means that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is the what? He's the king of the day of judgment. By the way, brothers and sisters, there's two recitations in this. There's the first one, which is Maliki bil alifi maddan. So you say Maliki. And if you say Maliki, it means al mutasarrifu bil fi'li fil ashya' al mamlukati lahu. But if you say Maliki, which is alifi qasran, and it's the qira'ah in which Asim and al Kisa'i and al Yaqub recite in, which is what? They recite Maliki. Okay? Maliki, Maliki, which is al-alif baddan, al-mutasarrifu bil-fi'li fi al-ashya' al-mamlukati lahu. This recitation is the recitation of who? It's recitation of Asim. It's the recitation of Kisa'i, Yaqub, Khalaf. And you can look more into this issue if you want in the kitab al-Nashr, Ibn al-Jazari, rahimahullah. The Baquna, they recited as what? Maliki. The remaining, they recited as what? Maliki. You can find that also in the kitab al-Nashr by al-Imam Ibn al-Jazari, rahimahullah. So Maliki Yawmiddin, it depends on how you recite it. If you recite it as Maliki Yawmiddin, it means al-mutasarrifu, the one who deals with, bil-fi'li, with action, fil ashya'i, in things, which al-mamlukati lahu, which he owns. Yani Allah tabarak wa ta'ala deals with things the way he wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And he does things, he controls things, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you say Maliki. And if you say Maliki, it means al-mutasarrifu bil-qawli, not bil-fi'li, but like bil-qawli, amran wa nahiyan. He commands them to do things. He tells them to stay away from things, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani malikun alayhim. That's what it means. Maliki yawmiddin. Two qira'as complement one another because they're from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah mentions it in the Qur'an, Surah Al-Infitar. He says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ ثُمَّ مَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. Also Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَرِثُ الْأَرْضَ وَمَنْ عَلَيْهَا وَإِلَيْنَا يُرْجَعُونَ. Also Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. يعني that day, يوم القيامة, no one has the kingdom. No one does. And so Allah's kingdom now is more clearer. It was always clear, but now it becomes clear for the creation as well. There were people trying to say, I'm a king of all kings. It now becomes clear to them. لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. Hey, who's the king of today? يَوْمَهُمْ بَارِزُونَ لَا إِخْفَى عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْهُمْ شَيْءٍ لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. Who's the king today? Hey, no one can answer. لله الواحد القهار. يوم الدين. يوم الدين, it means a يوم الجزاء والحساب. It means a day of accountability. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari mentions that in Ibn Kathir رحمه الله تعالى. إياك نعبدو. Oh Allah, you alone we worship. وإياك نستعين. And you, oh Allah, alone we seek help. And meaning إياك نعبدو, it means لا نعبدو إلا أنت. We don't worship anyone except you. متذللين لك. We humble ourselves for you. وحدك alone, لا شريك لا, you have no partners in worship. ولا نستعين إلا بك. Oh Allah, there's no one else that we seek help from except you, wahdaka, alone. La sharika laka, you have no partners in that. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim means, oh Allah, guide us to the straight path. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, it means, oh Allah, dulluna ala al-tariq al-wadih. Show us the straight path. The path, al-mustaqima, alladhi la wijaja fi. There's no deviation and crookedness in it. Oh Allah, show us that path. Not only just that, وَوَفِّقْنَا لِسُلُوكِ. Allow us, give us the ability and strength to be able to tread on that path. وَثَبِّتْنَا عَلِيهِ, and make us steadfast. Those three things. Show us the path, give us the ability to tread on that path, and keep us firm upon that path. Which path? صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. The path of those who you've become pleased with. The path of those in which you're pleased with. The path that we want Allah Ta'ala to place us on is the path of those people who Allah is what? He's pleased with. Like in brothers and sisters, the people Allah is pleased with have combined between two qualities and characteristics. They are a people who had knowledge and acted upon what they knew. They had knowledge and they acted upon what they knew. Their knowledge was based with sincerity and al-mutaba'ah. The knowledge that they had stood on two pillars. It was a knowledge based on sincerity and a knowledge that was based on al-mutaba'ah, following the Prophet ﷺ. That's the people we ask Allah Ta'ala to allow us to be from them. وَمَنْ يُطْعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. So أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ are these people. Okay? غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. After we've asked Allah to allow us to be on the path of those who He is pleased with, we're asking Allah to protect us from what? From the path of two groups of people. The first ones are who? غير المغضوب عليهم. The ones who you've become angry with. And those are the which people? They are the Jews who had what? They knew, they had knowledge, they had understanding, lakin they chose not to act upon what they knew. And Allah Ta'ala, when He speaks about the Jews in the Qur'an, one of the characteristics that He mentions of them is al-ghadab. Allah is angry with them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the characteristics, awsaf al-yahud, which is al-ghadab. As Allah said in the Qur'an, مَنْ لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ وَغَضِبَ عَلَيْهِ. Allah was talking about the Jews. Also Allah Ta'ala, He said about them, فَبَاءُ بِغَضَبٍ عَلَى غَضَبٍ. وَلِذَلِكَ, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam commented on this ayah, in the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, al-maghdubi alayhim al-yahud. Al-maghdubi alayhim, the Prophet said al-yahud. Ahmad narrated that hadith, Ibn Hibban narrated it, al-imam al-tabarani narrated it, al-haythami narrated in his kitab Mujma'u al-zawaid wa manba'u al-fawaid, and he mentions, he said, rijaluhu rijalu sahih. The only person in there that's, يعني, question mark might have gone on top of it, or there's a question mark on him, is Abbad ibn Hubaysh. Okay, and he's a thiqah. He's a thiqah, inshallah ta'ala. And an imam, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, hassana isnadahu. Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah, he authenticated the hadith, wa sahahahu bimajmu'u turuqihi. All of the chains, when he brought it together, Shaykh al-Albani authenticated it. If you go to his silsila, al-hadith al-sahiha, Shaykh Nasir, hadith 3263, Shaykh al-Albani speaks about it in great details, rahimahullah. So this shows, brothers and sisters, what? That after the Prophet commented on a verse and gave it a meaning, we just have to submit and listen. The Prophet said, al-maghdubi alayhim is al-yahud. Walad-dallina ahu, this is a characteristic of the Jews. The Christians. Dallina is a characteristic of the Christians. Walidharika, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He spoke about them and gave them this characteristic in the Quran. Allah says, qad dallu min qablu wa adallu كثيراً وضلوا عن سواء السبيل. And this was when Allah تبارك وتعالى was talking about the deviation and the misguidance of the Christians. And also the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim, which I just mentioned. In there, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, after he said المغضوب عليهم is the Yahud, he said ولا الضالين is the نصارى. The Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام. I'm going to stop there, inshallah تعالى. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdi, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Ramadan with AMAU. Make this the best Ramadan you've ever had by joining our exclusive online community with regular private classes, digital resources, weekly accountability sessions, and daily Qur'an gatherings. This is one opportunity you definitely do not want to miss. So sign up now at amau.org/Ramadan, and we look forward to welcoming you on the other side.